Well, good morning. Welcome to worship. Glad you guys are all here worshiping with us in person as well as online. Today is National Mother-in-Law Day. Didn't know that was a thing. But it gives me a chance to tell my favorite mother-in-law joke. What is the definition of mixed emotions? Definition of mixed emotions. When your mother-in-law is about to back off a cliff in your new Mercedes. There's mixed emotions. Right away, I just want to say to my mother-in-law who is watching online, I love you, and it's just a joke. It's not true. Absolutely not true. We're glad you're here in worship, and we want to pass the peace, give a greeting to one another. It's a beautiful part of what the body of Christ does every week. So let's gather together, stand up, find somebody, bless them, pass the peace of Christ, tell them you're glad that they exist.
Good morning and welcome to worship at Chapel Hill United Methodist Church in Wichita, Kansas. My name is Jeff Gannon. I'm the senior pastor. It is my privilege and honor to welcome you to worship. I want to invite you to get a candle and to light it as a symbol of Christ's presence with you as we worship together. I also want to encourage you to get out some bread and some grape juice or wine so that after the sermon today, we might participate together in the sacrament of Holy Communion. You are invited to our website, chwichita.org, and you will notice there that there's an opportunity to submit a prayer request. We genuinely hope that you will do that. We want to pray with and for you according to your needs. And if this service is a blessing to you and you feel led, we would invite you to also give financially. And there is an opportunity to do that at the website as well. Thank you again for joining us for worship, and may God bless you and inspire you today.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, God, I need you. Your forgiveness. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
Amen.
Dead man walk, enslaved to sin. I wanna know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you. So take me to the riverside. Take me under baptized. I need you. Oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of the symphony to my ears, like holy water on my skin. I want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of a symphony in my ears, like holy water, your forgiveness, like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of a symphony to my ears, like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water on my skin. Yeah, it's like holy water.
Amen. Amen. God, we are so thankful for your forgiveness, for your grace that we need every day, God. We know that you are always with us. In every situation, God, in every moment in our lives, your grace is right there, carrying us. And that's why we sing this morning.
Promise maker, promise keeper, you finish what you begin. Our provision through the desert, you see it through till the end. You see it through till the end. Yes, we can know you are good. The Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness, you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord. Without you, we won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you, we won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you, we won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need.
may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, Josh and Maddie and team. This is Neil Whitlow. You may know Neil. He is our Director of Discipleship Ministries, covering children, youth, and adults. Does an excellent job. We're very thankful for Neil. And he's going to introduce our newest staff member, and then she's going to introduce her family to us. So, Neil?
Absolutely. Many of you know that we were searching for a new children's discipleship coordinator, and the Lord answered our prayer a little over a month ago. Amber came on staff. She's been doing a job. She's got her first children's ministry event this afternoon with Trunk or Treat, so don't forget about that if you'd like to come from 3 to 5. But also thank you for your generosity with all the candy that you've donated for the trunks and everything. But she's been doing a great job coordinating that and getting that ready. And so this is Amber Lindberg. Come on up.
Hello, I'm so glad to be here. I'm excited. I've been very welcomed by everybody on staff and by all of you that I've met. And I'm excited for Trunk or Treat today. I'm excited for getting the opportunity to work with your kids. They're very smart about the Bible, so that's on you guys that you've done a great job with them. If anybody ever needs anything or you want to teach Sunday school, you can just contact me and we'll work that out.
All right. Amber's here with her daughter, Riley, her husband, Seth. If you'd like to come up up on the chancel, we'll pray for all of you.
Good morning and welcome. So, Amber, introduce the rest of your family, please.
Okay, this is kind of sad, but this is not all my family. This is my husband, Seth. This is my oldest daughter, Riley. I have another daughter that's 21 that's going to school in Oklahoma. And then I have a 14-year-old boy and a 12-year-old boy, but I figured since they're going to be here through Trunk or Treat till who knows when today, maybe we wouldn't bring them up on stage.
You're a wise woman. You're a wise woman. And so I'll anoint you, and then Neil will anoint your husband and daughter, if that's okay. It's a sign of God's blessing. It's also a powerful reminder from Scripture that when people are anointed, they're called, they're appointed to positions, and we're fully dependent on the Lord. So, Amber, we give thanks and praise to God for the gift of your life, and we mark you with the sign of the cross, so that you might always and everywhere know that you belong to Jesus, who loves you with a holy passion, who is with you every moment of every day. And we pray that he will bless the work of your hands in this place, that all that you do would bring honor and glory to him as we seek to follow in his way and to share his amazing grace and his profound love. Neil? We are incredibly grateful, O God, for this family, for their lives individually, and for their call to serve you in various places and ways. Thank you for this sacred moment, a gift of your grace, where we can ask for you to bless them in ways that would surprise them, in ways that would remind them that they are yours in this day and all the days to come. We thank you for your providential care for our congregation and pray in thanksgiving for Amber's ministry among us. May you indeed bless the work of her hands, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our applause is our way of saying welcome. We're so glad you're here. Welcome. Thank you. I want to invite you now, if you're able, to stand as we robustly sing the hymn of the day. Some of you heard me say a couple of weeks ago that John Wesley, our spiritual father, said, if you're going to sing, sing with gusto. And then St. Augustine said, just remember that when you sing, you pray twice.
a reading from the second epistle to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 9, 6 to 15. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your gracious generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. By the rendering of this ministry, not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your abundance to the confession of the gospel of Christ, and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with all others. While they long for you and pray for you, because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
My father, there is no shadow.
Amen. Well, good morning again. Well, that's kind of puny. Are you all awake out there this morning? So, Dr. J had one of these last week, but I want you to look on the screen. If I can get my clicker to work. Jeremy, we have a clicker issue. Well, Jeremy can show you the next slide.
Which one do you want?
The very next one. I have a feeling this is divine intervention saving you from a sermon today. It's moving there, but not back there. All right, well, look at that. Can you read it?
Yes.
On the road to success, there are no shortcuts. Now, I thought that was funny. Thank you, Linda. One out of 320 people or so thought that was funny. Dr. J, you set the tone with your joke this morning. Well, Dr. J didn't take any shortcuts with this book, I can tell you that, because this chapter in particular and this book in general just kind of rocks my world. And I don't know about you, but I know about me, and it is just one of those books I need to reread every single year because it just messes with me in a very good, healthy way. Am I the only one? The good and beautiful community. Well, today we're talking about what it means to be the generous community. So several years ago, before kids, Meredith and I went to Alamogordo, New Mexico. Have any of you been there? The White Sands National Park. It's beautiful. And I was on a preaching mission there at a UM church. And so we were on our way back through Dallas-Fort Worth. And we were in the airport. And all of a sudden, a priest, by virtue of his dress, he was wearing a yellow cape, kind of like the Knights of Columbus do. I was just reminded of this because I was at our Dillon's, and the Knights of Columbus were there with their yellow tops and the Tootsie Rolls and the buckets. Have any of you encountered them? I feel like I'm living on a different planet than any of you. So, we're sitting there getting ready for our next flight, and there was this man dressed as a priest with a Roman collar, black shirt with a yellow cape, and it had an orphanage on the front. I think he got the idea from the Knights of Columbus, actually. And he had his bucket, and he didn't have Tootsie Rolls, but he was collecting money, and people were walking by just putting money in here and there. And my wife, Meredith, has a spiritual gift of discernment, so she said, "He's not a priest." I said, "What? He's dressed like a priest." She said, "He's not a priest." Because I wanted to help him and this orphanage. All of a sudden, this person came up to him and exposed him. And he tore off his collar and he threw the cape behind and ran as fast as he could with his bucket of money. Now, that kind of stuff messes with me. It might not mess with you. Because I don't want to be scammed, but I want to be generous. But I want to be wise. Are y'all with me this morning? I think I'm only preaching to myself today. It's like, I don't know how to be generous and yet deal with the feeling of somebody taking advantage. Well, then, I'm in a ride-along with the HOT team of the Wichita Police Department. Do you know what the HOT team is? Homeless Outreach Team. Specialists that deal with the homeless. And they don't get enough recognition. Boy, do they know what they do and how to do it. So I'm with this officer, and he said, "By the way, we were driving by, and we saw this." And he said, "So what do you tend to do with that?" I said, "It messes with me." He said, "Well, it should." I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, the last person that I had interaction with was taking in about $800 a week. "What?
He said, and then we tracked him, and he had a pimp, for lack of a better expression, who was really collecting the money, and he was getting paid. Now, that messes with me. I don't think it messes with you. I'm not seeing any reaction here. It's like, I want to be generous, but I don't like that. Thank you. Three of you can agree with what... I'm just messing with you. So then I go to Dr. J's chapter on generosity, and it messes with me again in a very good, healthy way. I want to be a generous person. I know you want to be a generous person, but then you have stuff like that. And the hot team officer said, don't ever give because you're just enabling the problem. And I said, yes, but Jesus said, give to every person who begs of you. See what I mean? A mixed message. Have you figured out how to deal with that in your life? I'm still trying how to figure it out in my life. And then I read this chapter. It's like, okay, well, what's the first false narrative that Dr. J points out? God helps those who help themselves. Now, who said it? Is it in the Bible? It's not in the Bible, but who said it? Ben Franklin. And as Dr. J says in the book, if you haven't read the chapter yet, he said a lot of very wise things, but this was not one of them. That's a false narrative. God helps those who help themselves. Let me quote Dr. J. This judgmental narrative is a bulwark against generosity, a sturdy protection against the need to help those in need. Instead of feeling guilty, I can look at those who are in need and judge them. Judging makes my guilt go away. Profound words. And I'm not speaking for you. I'm only speaking for myself, that my judgmentalism pops up when I feel scammed or I am scammed. We live in Bel Air, as most of you know, and we have a monthly newspaper that has the monthly police report, and two Bel Air citizens were scammed, one out of $250,000 and another at $100,000, and every month you see scamming. And it messes with me, and I'm overusing that word on purpose because I'm in this place of ambivalence. How do you be generous and yet wise? How do you be generous yet discerning? How do you be generous yet prudent? It's hard, isn't it? And yet, Dr. J, or more importantly, the Holy Spirit through Dr. J, convicted me again about how easy it is for me to be judgmental of those that I just want to say, get a job. So, the true narrative for that is that God helps those who cannot help themselves, and God helps those who can help themselves. Now, that is a biblical concept, and I don't have the time to show you the scripture. You're going to have to trust me and look it up on your own. But the good news is that God is very active in this world, and God does not show favorites toward those he likes and those he doesn't. God doesn't play that game. God is good to all people in varieties of ways, in places, experiences. So I'm going to quote Dr. J a lot today. The Gospels are a who's who of helpless, broken, despised people, yet God helps them. The woman caught in adultery, dead Lazarus, Peter making promises he cannot keep. The prejudice narrative must be overcome if we are to become generous. So recently, I'm a real fan of the Lord's Diner. I think Bishop Gerber had this God-given vision to create the Lord's Diner, and then we asked Catholic Charities if they'd put a Lord's Diner in Plainview for all the obvious reasons of that neighborhood, and Bishop Olmsted said, if we have hungry children, there will be a Lord's Diner, and there was. Thanks be to God. But I heard the other day of a pastor who, from his pulpit here in our city, announced to his congregation, if you choose to volunteer at the Lord's Diner, it's not going to be because it's a ministry of this church. Because those people are being enabled to be lazy. Now, I'm not being critical of the pastor because I'm exposing my own tendency toward the judgmentalism. That's the only reason I'm telling you that story. It's real easy to go there, at least for me. But it's a false narrative because the God that we know in Jesus is a God who is always gracious and good toward all. And sometimes we don't discern well, and sometimes we give well, and sometimes we're used well. And then I think, ooh, that's a Greek word, ooh. I'm still trying to find the actual translation into English, but it's there somewhere, ooh. And then I was lamenting to one of my good spiritual director friends, and he said, well, I think maybe you ought to just leave everything else up to God. You do what you're called to do in a moment, and then leave God with the results. Let God produce the results. Let God manage the people that scam you or those who don't. False narrative number two, if I give it away, I have less. Now, we have to be honest about this. Many of us were raised with this false narrative. Many. And it's rooted in scarcity. And scarcity tends to be a generational thing. So when we have all of our couples go through premarital counseling, and we have a staff counselor who provides that as a ministry of our church, and she does an excellent job, and she uses curriculum that is very well known from the Gottman Institute in Seattle. And one of the things that she does with them is what's called a genogram, where you do a family mapping. And generosity and scarcity tends to be generational. So when you see a person who has tendencies toward being extravagantly generous or incredibly stingy, they're not typically the first one. You can see it in a family map, and it gets passed down generation after generation after generation. And the good news is the cycles can be broken. And the good news is that some of those tendencies are really good and positive, and some of them are really negative. And people that are raised with a scarcity narrative are raised to think what is on the screen. You can't be too generous because it costs. And the mindset is on loss. It's zero-sum thinking. What I give, I've lost forever. Now, I learned generosity from my mother. She didn't teach it. She practiced it. So I always say, is generosity taught? Yes, but it's mostly caught. So is stinginess. So is scarcity. It's caught. It's in the air. So I'll never forget the day as a teenager when I had $600 that I wanted to give to our church so that we could buy some chalkboards. Now, back in the 80s, $600 was a whole lot more than it is now. And being raised in a small eastern Montana town, we did have a bank, and the banker was a member of our church. His name, Ellis Jones, and his wife, Irene, worked in the bank as well. Some of you can picture this. It's a small town. I walk in there, and I will never forget the day. I was in the eighth grade, and I had written a check in aqua ink. I can see the check in my mind's eye because this had such an indelible experience for me, an impression on me. So I write the check out for $600 to get the cash to pay for the chalkboard. And why I felt the need to get a cashier's check, that part I don't remember my thinking. But that's what my goal was. And Irene Jones happened to be working the counter. And I go up and I say, Mrs. Jones, I didn't call her Irene, Mrs. Jones, I would like to get a cashier's check in the amount of $600. She said, why are you doing that? Now, this is small town stuff, right? That expression of the village raises a child, it's true in a small town. She says, why are you doing that? Does your mother know what you're doing? I said, well, she does. I wanted to say, it's none of your blankety blank business, but that would not have been appropriate, especially as an eighth grader, right? I'm being way too real with you. So I said, well, Mrs. Jones, the church needs some chalkboards. She says, well, I haven't heard about the need for chalkboards. I said, well, we talk about it. I wasn't going to say, well, Mrs. Jones, you haven't been in church in 3 months, so you wouldn't know. So I am saying to her, I'm going to buy these chalkboards. She said, you shouldn't do that. Now, we're having this dialogue in the bank. It's a small town bank. Have I said that enough times for you to realize there's nothing else to do? So I guess I'm helping her pass the time. I said, well, Mrs. Jones, this is what I want to do. I don't think that's a good idea. And do you realize that when you give this $600, you have lost it forever? I said, well, what am I supposed to do? Don't give it. I said, well, Mrs. Jones, I need to do this. I just don't think it's a good idea. Because once you give it, you've lost it. That's the mindset. See, it's a scarcity mindset. Well, what's the true narrative? If we all share the way that God has designed the universe to work, and in particular the kingdom of God, when we all share, we will all have enough. So look at what the scripture says. Rita read so well. Isn't she a great reader? The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will reap sparingly. The one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not regretfully or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. That's how God has designed this universe to work. And we, in our free will, can cooperate that and agree with that and live into that, or we can come against it and say, God, I don't think you know what you are doing. Now, I'm pointing all fingers at myself. If there's anything in this for you, praise God. What Mrs. Jones wasn't realizing is that when we give generously, it's not that we play games with God, but we cannot outgive God. Because it will come back in one form or another in multitudes of ways. Isn't it true? An anonymous quote that I love: the only thing we take with us when we die is what we give away. I'm not just talking about material things. I'm talking about the whole of life. And what we give away is what forms our legacy. So, who is this? Now, Margaret, you're the Jeopardy queen, so if you can't get this, we're in trouble. You've been here's a clue. You've been hearing a lot about this man recently, indirectly. Alfred Nobel. Now, for the sake of time, I can't give you all the details, but I need to give you enough. Dr. Alfred Nobel came from a very prominent family. His brother died And they thought it was Alfred who died. And the major newspapers printed his obituary. And they said, in quotes, "Dr. Alfred Nobel, who became rich by finding ways to kill more people faster than ever before, died yesterday. The merchant of death is dead." He read that, and he said, "That's not the legacy I want to leave. That's how I'm going to be remembered if I were to die today." So we now have what's called the Nobel Peace Prize, because he said, "My legacy will not be for the things that I invented that create for death and destruction, but I want to be remembered for how I have created peace and life." Isn't that amazing? False narrative number three. I got to pick it up here, folks. "What I have is mine to use for my own pleasure." This is another one of those that gets me. "What I have is mine to use for my own pleasure." This entitlement narrative teaches us that the things we possess, whether money, time, or abilities, are ours to see fit, which often means using them for our own gain and not the benefit of others. Here's the true narrative. What's mine is God's, and I'll share it for God's glory and the blessing of others. Here's the thing. I need this lesson. I suspect maybe one or two of you need this lesson. We don't own anything. God owns it all. But God trusts us to steward our soul, our body, our time, our talent, our treasure. God owns your brain, Sherry. The question is for you and for me and for all of us, are we stewarding our intellect? Are we stewarding our spiritual side? Are we stewarding our material side? Are we stewarding, even if we have children or grandchildren or nieces or nephews or cousins or parents, we steward the love. It's not ours. And my favorite definition of stewardship is taking care of something or someone that belongs to someone else. We don't own it. But God says, "I trust you. I trust you to steward it, care for it." Dr. Jace says, "Generosity is an attitude or inward disposition that spawns acts of self-sacrifice, which is how God acts toward us." I need the reminder that God is the most generous being in the universe. God is not stingy. God is gracious. God is good. God is giving and giving and giving. One of the most powerful sermons I heard as a young person in the small Methodist church I was raised in came from this least likely voice, Lottie Eisenbart. Have you ever heard of such a name? Lottie Eisenbart. She was the superintendent of our Sunday school. And our pastor couldn't get to our church because the winters in Montana can be quite severe. And so Lottie stood in the pulpit and said, "I got a call from the pastor. He can't be here today," because he had to drive 30 minutes to get there. But she said, "I have the most brief sermon." I didn't learn how to preach brief sermons from Lottie, but I learned that when she spoke, I need to learn from her and listen to her. And it was Advent, and we were getting ready for Christmas. And her sermon today was, "I don't know what to tell you other than this, that when I think about Advent and the coming of Christ into the world, For God so loved the world that he gave. And she sat down. He gave. So let me close. A generous community is formed of people where there's no judgment or prejudice. We leave that to God. There's no scarcity mindset or practice because God is able. And there's no what's mine is mine and I'm going to keep it and don't you dare mess with what's mine. God, I worked hard to get this. It's mine, mine, mine. And LBK, you're needed in the nursery. But the invitation is to say yes to grace, even when people don't deserve it. We can do that with wisdom. We can do that with discernment. We can do that with prudence. And we can say yes to abundance. Just because God is abundant, we can reflect God's image and likeness in that way. And then we can say yes to what's mine is God's, and I will generously share it. And don't you dare forget, I'm not just talking about money. I'm talking about the whole of life, our soul, our spirit, our body, our time, our talent, our treasure, the whole of life. Everything is God's. So, generous communities don't just give to what is needed. Generous communities give in response to what God has already given and all that God has done. And that's why Dan Bennett, our chair of our board, is here, as promised, to give you a quick update on where we are in this aspect of our generosity. Thank you, Dan. Would you give him a hand for leading us so well?
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Chapel Hill, for welcoming me to share the financial report for this quarter. But after that sermon, now I know I'm sharing the generosity report. So you can go to the next slide, please. So it's a great report. The people of Chapel Hill have responded this year in an amazing way, and I have reported that quarterly, and it's been a pleasure, and it's been amazing to see what's happened this year. So we've given to a level that we've never given before at this time of the year. We hit $1 million at the end of September, and so that's a record, and it's up 16% from last year. So it's a pretty amazing report on generosity. Overall, our position is very positive, as it's been throughout the year. We're at a place now that we need another $470,000 to close the year out on budget. Next slide, please. And expenses are tracking along within our budget right now. So consequently, if we can raise the $470,000 between now and the end of the year, we will end the year in the black, which is always our goal, and that'd be wonderful. We remain in a very strong position with an operating balance that will cover up to 7 months of expenses. Our goal is 6 months, so we're exceeding our goal there. That's all good. Next slide, please. And as we've talked about all year, we're intent on getting rid of our debt. We still owe $1.8 million, and that number has shrunk this year as I've given this report. It's on loan at 3.6%. That's the good news. The bad news is it matures next month. So we've got a decision to make. We're sitting on almost $600,000 of capital funds that we can apply toward that debt. And that's earning almost 5%. So that's the interest rate spread we've talked about the last few times. But that's about to come to a dramatic end with the loan maturing, and we refinance at the current interest rates. And as I've talked about before, we've been named by a trust for $1 million gift when that trust is settled. So that trust is not settled yet, so We're still eager and excited about that happening sometime in the near future. In terms of plans for the future, we've talked a lot about we want to pay the debt off and become debt-free. That's still our goal. We want to do that as soon as possible. With the maturity in November, our plan right now is to pay down the debt to $1 million and refinance that number. We are meeting with the bank this coming week to talk about different options to accomplish that, but our general plan is to continue to pay down $26,000 a month, which is our current payment. If we did that in 48 months, we could pay off another $1 million. So we have multiple ways to attack this, and we certainly plan to continue to. Back on the discussion of the 470 we need between now and year end, in the past, we've used a thermometer to report to you through the newsletter, and that's an interesting technique, but it actually might, as we've talked about generosity and building a culture of generosity at Chapel Hill, you know, what the thermometer really teaches is when there's a need, you give to it. And Jeff talked about really a new way to think about it, which is we give in gratitude to what God has given us. And I think that's what we're seeing at Chapel Hill. That's what we've seen as I reported this entire year of a growth in this attitude and culture of generosity. And I thank you for that. And we're certainly moving in the right direction. So thank you for your time today.
Grateful to Dan for his leadership, and thank you again for your generosity. Pastor Jen's going to lead us now in a time of prayer.
Let's go to God in prayer, my friends. Oh God, we thank you for the reminder of your faithfulness, the reminder that we can't outgive you. Oh God, you are so good to us. We pray that you would stoke within us the fires of generosity, that we might give in your name, in all ways, in our hearts. God, we thank you for the gift of Amber and her ministry among us, and we pray your blessing on her and on her family. We thank you for the promise of peace in the midst of grief, and so we pray for the family of Phyllis Welk as they continue to grieve her death. We pray for Lori and Jim Reber in the death of Lori's mother. We pray for Tyson and Jenny Hurt and their family in the death of Tyson's grandmother. And we pray for Kent Kellums and his family in the death of his cousin. God, we pray for healing and strength for those who are struggling today with physical, mental, emotional, spiritual issues, needs. We pray for Wendy Estes, for Jen Melker, Jerry Wilson, Priscilla Salem, Dan Smart, Sherry Wilson, Debbie Adams, Larry Rapp, Harvey DePew, and all the many on our prayer list, as well as those we carry in our own hearts. Thank you, O God, that you already know that your faithfulness is already going before, behind, all around. And so in that assurance, we turn now to the giving of our tithes and our offerings, and we ask that you receive all that we give, that we might glorify you with every breath that we take, for we pray in Christ's name. Amen and amen. As our ushers come forward to wait upon the congregation, I invite you, if you haven't already, to find the connection folders. They'll be on the center aisle of each row. Inside, you'll find a way to let us know that you're here, and we want to know. We want to be able to connect. You'll also find prayer request cards that you can use to let us know how we can pray with and for you. Thank you.
I invite those who are helping to serve communion to come forward at this time. I'll give a brief word about how we take communion after we pray the Lord's Prayer together. You may be saying, you tell us how to do it every week and it's on the screen. But we do have guests and we want them to feel comfortable in knowing how we do it. And so I'll give that brief word after we pray together. But join me now, please, in the prayer we call the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, it is a good and joyful thing everywhere and always to give thanks to you, Almighty God. You are the creator of heaven and earth and all things. And so we join together, join our voices with all the company of heaven as together we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is Jesus who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. On the night when the Lord Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so we're bold to pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine, that they may be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with you, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes again in final victory and we all feast at his heavenly banquet. All glory, honor, and praise is yours, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Together, let us pray the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Table is now open. It is an open table. Everyone is welcome. If you are new here, you are welcome to this. It is Jesus' table, and all are invited. We take communion here by method of intinction. That means you come forward from the right front of the section with open hands, and you receive the wafer, and then you dip that into the cup, and then eat that. Some of you come from traditions where you take the wafer and about every other week, somebody pops it right in their mouth, and it's that awkward moment of, okay, wait a minute, do I pull it back out? I get that a lot. It happens, trust me. Don't pull it back out. I'll give you another one. But you dip that, and then you take that and return back to your seats. We have a gluten-free station back by the doors.
Down, I will sing
of the goodness of God. Close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so. So good, with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
Just a few things for you, for each of us to be the body of Christ in the world today and throughout this next week and beyond. Just a quick reminder, Trunk or Treat is at 3 during the Chiefs game, so we thought it would be good to practice sacrifice. Dr. J, we did it just for you. So the youth fundraiser for pies, not the kind that go in our faces, but for your Thanksgiving meal, you can sign up in the fellowship hall at the donut table following this service. And the youth are going to decorate them. It's going to be a wonderful experience, and it'll save you from having to bake one. So thank you in advance. Next
Actually, November the 10th, we're celebrating our veterans among us. So if you are a veteran, we would like to know that, number one. And if you've been on an honor flight, we want to know that as well. So call the church office because we want to be able to name you in that service on November the 10th. So call soon, please. And then this is the last Sunday for us honoring and celebrating Beggarman Ministries. You can see during the month of October, we're collecting those items and beyond. There's a sheet if you want more options. But thank you again for your generosity. Beggarman Ministries helps people get back on their feet in a very empowering way. So it's a wonderful ministry. Pastor Ben is going to be at the cross to pray with and for you according to your needs. But now I want to invite you, if you're able to stand, and if you're comfortable, find the hand of your neighbor. Looks like we're going to have to get a little more creative here today. You know, connection is intentional, and sometimes it takes us out of our comfort zone. And sometimes it's a stretching experience in more ways than one. But sisters and brothers in Christ, as we go forth into this new week, may you never forget that for God so loved the world, and that includes you and me, that God gave. In that spirit, bless the world with your life and your love. And as you and I go forth, may we always know we live in the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Let's sing Go With God.
Go with the wind at your back and the sun on your face, with a song in your heart and the promise of grace. Go in peace and in truth and let love lead your way. Go with God. Go with God. The wind at your back and the sun on your face, with a song in your heart and the promise of grace. Go in peace and in truth and let love lead your way. Go with God.